I would like to be here. I would like to be there. I would like to be everywhere at once. I know that's a contradiction in terms, and it's a problem.
The third year, or the so-called advanced year of the BMI Music Theatre Workshop, and this is now taking us from right about 1972, 1973, you're meant to really begin your own project in earnest. And I had always, always loved and worshipped Fellini's great masterpiece film, Eight and a Half. I should say that part of growing up during the 60s and coming of age during the 60s, for Americans was the discovery of European art cinema. And so we were all, you know, from Antonioni to Satyajit Ray to Bergman to Fellini. I mean, those are the movies that we loved and that we saw. And I've often analyzed why it was I was drawn to Eight and a Half. And I think I was drawn to it predominantly because I was an adolescent. And if you look at the themes of Eight and a Half, it's a man going through a midlife crisis, almost going through a second adolescence, and all those things that adolescence implies: the nature of your sexuality, your relationship to women, your ability to be monogamous, what is the meaning of your life, what's the relationship between your life and your work, are you a grown-up, are you losing your sense of childhood, are you coming to the limitations of your possibilities when approaching, all of those adolescent things that you think about, you go through. And so I think I identified with the main character, Guido. And he was so cool. I mean, I'm sure Mastroianni was amazingly cool. And the women were beautiful. And I simply loved this piece. And when I thought about the idea of writing it, I of course it was going to be a student piece. In the same way that when I was a senior at Yale, I wrote a cello concerto as a senior project, and I knew it would never be played. As it turned out, Yo-Yo Ma ultimately played it, but I didn't know that at the time. And so this was really something that was never going to see the light of day. I didn't have the rights to it, because I was never going to need the rights to it. And I simply wrote it from love of the subject matter, which I think is the credo I live by and the credo that I try to impart to every writer that I know, which is you must write from where you get your best ideas. And, you know, if you never do get those rights and you never do get your show on, well, then you've written something very good to keep your pencil sharp, and it'll make you a better writer, because you can only learn writing by writing. But there I was writing this project, and I instantly called it Nine because it was a joke. And that gave it comedy. Well, you know, it's Eight and a Half, but with a little extra music, so it's really Nine. But I instinctually knew at that time that the only reason you would do something like this would be to make it different. The only reason you would turn something into a musical, adapt something into a musical, was because you had something to say. You could transform it. There's a wonderful music theory treatise written in German by a music theorist named Joseph Riepel. I think this book was actually used by Beethoven as one of the foundations of musical composition. Anfangsgründe zur musikalischen Setzkunst, I think that's what it's called. But in any case, it's a dialogue between a student and a teacher. And at one point, the student says to the teacher, "Maestro, is borrowing allowed in music?" And the teacher says, "Yes, as long as you pay back with interest." And I think that's the essence of writing a musical. Because if you take a project, a masterpiece that's so perfect that you wouldn't want to take anything out of it, then there's no room for 80 minutes of dancing and singing. But if there's a trope, if there's an homage, if you can do something that's inspired by something and make it your own, in the same way that some writers could take a book of short stories called Tales of the South Pacific, merge those stories into 2.5 hours of music theater, merge three women into one woman, or take short stories by Sholem Aleichem, or in the case of How to Succeed in Business, take a book of cartoons.
She will tell you, "You never say I love you, it's too English, don't love like the enclave."